So far, whatever we have discussed, that is the examples of input device. Now we will go for the processing part in the information processing cycle. After the input, okay, these input devices, they feed the input signal to the computer. They convert the input signal into binary form. Okay, now we have the binary data. We need to process the binary data. So we have the CPU, okay, central processing unit. As I stated earlier, the CPU is the brain of the computer. Okay. So if you just imagine if there is no CPU, what is your input? If that block is not there, whatever the input, the same thing is your output. Okay. There is no job for the output device and the input device. So for processing only, we are using computers. Okay. So this is the brain for the processing. CPU is the brain. As I said earlier, so in the memory, you have the instructions. Okay. I want to find out the factorial. I want to find out the factorial of some number. Okay. So the corresponding instructions, whatever you are programming, okay, those instructions are stored in the memory. Even the data is also stored in the memory. So what it does, okay, this CPU fetches the instructions from the memory, and then it interprets. Okay, based on the instructions, it will act on the data. Whether I have to add the data, I have to subtract the data, I have to multiply the data. Okay, so the instructions and the data, they are available in the memory. CPU has to process it. Okay. As I said earlier, CPU executes, perform the required computation. After performing, again, it has to store the result in some memory, or directly it has to output to the output device. It has to display the output in the output device. Okay. So CPU, as we discussed in the block diagram, CPU has three main components. One is arithmetic and logic unit, okay, ALU. In microprocessors and microcontrollers, you will be studying this ALU in detail. Then control unit, okay, this is very important. So it will control whether you are receiving the input properly, whether the operations, whether the given as per the instructions, whether the processing is done. Whether the output is reaching to the output device, okay, all those things this control unit will control. And you need, of course, okay, you need memory registers. Say for example, I have five numbers, 5, 10, 15, 20. I have to add all these five numbers. Let me take another number. So how it works means it will add these two number. You have this intermediate result, okay. So you need to give the net addition added value to the output device, not the intermediate device. So you have some memory registers, there the intermediate results are stored. With this value, the new number is added, and again you will have some intermediate result that is added to this. So that's how the computation works. Okay, so you have the memory units. So first we will discuss arithmetic and logic unit, ALU. As the name suggests, it is used to perform the arithmetic operations and logical operations. Okay, it is used to perform arithmetic operations and logical operations. So arithmetic operations, the basic addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Okay, the basic addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, it can do. These are the examples of mathematical operations, arithmetic operations, and logical operations. Say I have two ages, okay. Say there are two students in my class, X and Y. Okay, leave about the age. So he is scoring, first student is scoring 50 in the first exam, another student is scoring 49. So I'm going to compare whether they scored equal marks. Okay, they are not equal. or I'm going to check whether x is greater than y or x is less than y. All these are logical operations. Okay, so actually these logical operations are carried out in the ALU. Then we will move to control unit. Okay, this is a very important thing. Actually, it controls, as the name suggests, it controls. Okay, it coordinates and controls the data flow in and out of CPU. Okay, you have central processing unit, you have input, output. So the input is some data, output is some data. Okay, so it has to monitor. Okay, similarly, it controls the operations of ALU, memory register, input units, and output units. You have different input units, you have different output units. Okay, from the input unit, you have to receive the data. After processing, you have to forward or feed the output to the output units. Okay, in between, you have memory units, you have to fetch from the instructions from the memory. You have to do arithmetic logical operations. So all these things are controlled and coordinated by the control unit. Okay, so as I said earlier, it is responsible for carrying out all the instructions stored in the program. Say I am just writing a program. Okay, that program is fetched to the memory. So this control unit takes care whether whatever, say I am just designing a simple calculator, that program has to perform addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. Okay, so this control unit ensures that whether all the operations, all the instructions stored in the program are executed properly. Okay, so this point already we have discussed. So it fetches the instruction, interprets it, and accordingly it controls the input and output devices. Say for example, I am just in Python, I am just using a input command. Okay, whenever I am using this input keyword, through the keyboard you need to give the input. Say for example, I want to add two numbers. A is one variable, B is another variable. Again, I am just using input. Okay, here you write enter the first number, enter the second number. Two ways you can do. Directly I can give A equal to 10, B equal to 5, C equal to A plus B. But every time, say the input is varying. So I'm just using input command. So what it will do, it is expecting, your system is expecting some input from the input unit. That means from keyboard. If you don't give the input, the program will wait. Until you supply the input, the program will wait. Okay. So whether you are receiving the input from the input device, that also this particular control unit, okay, that takes care. Finally in the CPU we have memory registers. Okay, these are temporary units. As I said earlier, if you want to add 5 numbers, okay, I don't want the intermediate results, only the final results I want to feed to the output unit. The intermediate results, after adding these two, I will get a number. This is added to the next number and the previous result is overwritten. So this is basically a temporary unit. Okay, memory registers are temporary unit. They are used to store the data directly from the processor. You have the processor. So processor will operate, it will process the signal, that intermediate results, it will directly store in the registers. Okay, registers have different size, 16-bit, 32-bit, 64-bit. If you see, while installation, you might have noticed whether it is a 32 bit or 64 bit. Okay, actually that is basically the register size. So these registers has specific functionalities, like as I said earlier, storing the data, storing the instruction, and for each storage you have some address. Okay, if you are familiar in C language, you might have heard about pointers. Okay, so they basically refer to the address. So this registers, it stores the data. Okay, it stores the instructions and it stores the address of the memory location. Okay, where this particular thing is stored, address of memory location. Okay. So this is very much useful in assembly language programming. What is assembly language? We have separate slides there. We will discuss assembly language. So it is used to store operands and the intermediate results in assembly level language. Then accumulator. Okay, accumulator is the main register. Okay, that's very important. Accumulator is the main register. It contains one of the operands of the operation to be performed in the ALU. Okay, so in ALU you have accumulator, that is the main register actually. Okay, you have a separate course called the computer organization. There you will study very detailed things about these things. Then other than registers, if you see, you have internal memory. Okay. If you purchase a mobile phone or a laptop, you will be asking about what is the size of random access memory. Okay. Whether it is 2 GB or 3 GB or 8 GB, like that. Okay. You know that, roughly you know that this particular RAM actually that decides the speed of the system. Okay. There are not only RAM, there are many things like a processor, all those things, but you will ask the specification what is the size of RAM. Okay. Basically, it is a internal memory. Okay. Suppose if you are purchasing a mobile phone, you have some internal memory. There you can store certain images, not images, some data. It can be an image, audio, video, all those things. It has some limited memory capacity. After that, if you want, you will go for that memory card kind of thing. So this internal memory is actually divided into storage locations. Okay, so where you can store data and instructions. Then each memory location, it has some address. That is very important. Okay, with the address only you can access the data. Each memory location, it has some address. Then with the help of address, the computer can read any memory location easily without having to search the entire memory. Okay, otherwise you have to go for the entire memory and you have to search. If you know the address, directly the computer will find out. Okay. And another thing, when while executing the program, I have written a program, while executing the program, the data, okay, that is copied to the internal memory, okay, then the processing is happening. Until the execution, the data is there in the internal memory, primary memory or internal memory. Okay. As I said earlier, you can call internal memory, primary memory, main memory, okay, or you can also call this as random access memory. Okay, random access memory. Okay, why it is called random access? The name itself tells it is random access. Why it is called random access memory means the time of access of data is independent of location. Okay, say I'm just getting some data at 8 o'clock. Okay. See, it is not stored, okay, sequentially, something like, first it should be stored here. Whatever I am doing at 9 o'clock, saving, that should be stored. It's not like that, okay. The time of access of data is independent of its location in memory. That's why this is called a random access memory. You can access anytime. It's independent of its location, okay. So, we have discussed input unit, we came for the processing side, which is called the CPU. CPU has three important units, arithmetic logic unit, control unit and memory unit. Okay, in the memory you have registers, you have the main memory. Okay,